Okay, good evening, everyone. I welcome you to this new session, Interrogating the Art Pedagogy, which has been started as part of the exhibition Lokame Tharavadu, The World is One Family, which is curated by Prof. Kochi-Muziris and organized by the Kochi Biennale Foundation. And as part of the various academic outreach activities of this exhibition, we are having artist talks, the panel discussion, which is called as Where Are You From? Which is attempting to interrogate the idea of home, belonging, and identity. Similarly, in this series of lectures, we are trying to assess the conditions of art pedagogy in India, and also with a special focus on Kerala. And as part of that, as you know, we have invited various speakers and who have given their insights on the art pedagogy. And today with us, we have Professor Sunil Manghani, who is the professor of theory, practice, and critique. And he's also the director of research at the Winchester School of Art, University of Southampton, UK. He is the editor of the Journal of Visual Art Practice and the managing editor of Theory, Culture, and Society. His books include Image Studies, published in 2013, Zero Degree Seeing, 2019, India's Biennale Effect, published in 2016, and Farewell to Visual Studies in 2015. He has also curated Barthes/Burgin, referring to Roland Barthes and Victor Burgin at the John Hansard Gallery in 2016, along with building an art biennale in 2018 and Itinerant Objects 2019 at Tate Exchange, Tate Modern. It's a great pleasure to have you, Professor Manghani, and we all are looking forward to hear from you. Thank you for taking out your time and joining us today. And as I was also discussing with you that your extensive contributions in image studies, it spills over to so many areas and various concerns, especially related to conducting image-based research, and also the methodologies that we should familiarize ourselves with in order to do image-based research. And your detailed analysis about the correlation between text and images, the careful reading of the processes behind the image-based search, and which we carry out on websites, and most importantly, proposing an interdisciplinary approach to image making and image consuming is very fruitful for anyone who is engaging with images very seriously. And there is another important reason why I invited Professor Manghani as part of this series is because, as I have also written in my social media posts, that one of the most important limitations of conventional art history courses in the BFA and PMFA level is that it does not allow art students to think beyond the artworks they encounter in these survey courses as part of their art history courses. And that becomes the main repository of images through which they condition their art practice in the coming few years. And at this level, they are also not exposed to an interdisciplinary approach towards images and image making. And moreover, these courses do not provide critical tools to analyze the diverse context in which images are produced and consumed. And I have greatly benefited from Professor Manghani's writings and research on images to overcome this problem and introduce students to the ecology of images. He problematizes the idea of images and asks us to take images very seriously. According to Professor Manghani, I quote him, "There are genuine and far-reaching political, social, and cultural ramifications stemming not only from the use of images, but from our understanding of their use," unquote. Therefore, he reminds us that it will be very important for all of us to develop a rigorous and very careful engagement with images. The image as a repository of knowledge and a tool of communication. It demands a professional treatment from all disciplines. I welcome you, Professor Manghani, and please go ahead with your presentation. Bose Krishnamachari is here. He is the director of the Kochi-Muziris Biennale. Bose, please join us and please, if you want to share something, please go ahead.
Hi everyone. Hi, Sunil Manghani, it is fantastic to see you again after a long time. So I'm sure everybody will enjoy the conversation. And I just wanted to say hello to you and hope everything is fine at your end. And also, I just wanted to give you a small information from the state government. You know, Chief Secretary just called a few minutes ago. And he said we can go ahead with the exhibition happening in the Lokame Tharavadu can be opened soon. Yeah. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Sunil. And yeah. Thank you.
Boys, thank you so much. It's lovely to hear from you. Lovely to see you. And lovely to hear that the government are letting things go forward. And I do hope everything's good with everyone where you all are. It's obviously been a very, very difficult time. So good evening to everyone. And Premjish, thank you so much for your invitation and also for such a lovely, generous introduction. So thank you. It's really lovely. So let's hope I can live up to your expectations. It's interesting, this question about the image and art pedagogy. I think in some ways what I will talk today and what my work has does sit slightly out, sort of slightly outside of art pedagogy. And I think that's in an interesting way. So let's hope it plays out in that way. I'm going to talk mainly about my book, Image Studies, Image Studies Theory and Practice, which was published by Routledge back in 2013. It seems like such a long time ago now. If I were to write the book today, I'm sure it would be very different, but I'll let you all decide on that. I'm certainly not going to write it again or something like it, but yeah, I really welcome people's thoughts on it, and we can push it and pull it and break it and do what we want with it. But I hope it's worth considering, even though it goes back to 2013. I think what I tried to do in the book retains currency, I hope, not least because the question or the topic of the image is just an enduring one. It's a kind of irresolvable one, which I think I'll hopefully get onto in what I have to say. So for the purposes of today, I'm going to assume that most of you have not come across the book. Apologies for those who do know more, but I hope what I say will be of value anyway. So I'm going to start with a bit of a kind of tour of the book, focusing on kind of its framing and what I hoped it might offer. And then I'm going to turn to a more speculative text of mine that I published more recently, last year in fact, called Image Degree Zero. Now it's just an essay. So I'm going to try and put those two elements, the book and the essay, together, and we'll see how we go. So I'm going to start with the term visual culture. The opening of John Berger's very well-known book, Ways of Seeing, which I'm sure many of you have come across, but dates back to the early 1970s, but is always republished every year. It eloquently begins with the construction of seeing and looking. We only see what we look at. That's his line, that's Berger's line. To look is an act of choice, he says. And he goes on to say, we never look at just one thing. We're always looking at the relation between things and ourselves. Our vision is continually active, continually moving, continually holding things in a circle around itself, constituting what is present to us as we are. Now, John Berger writes of vision from the perspective of the artist. You know, he frequently would draw his experience of drawing from life, of observing things around him and trying to render what's around him on the page, is his way of describing how we see, how we picture the world. So both in terms of how it appears to us visually, but also how we describe it, whether in words or pencil lines. And if any of you have not read his later book called Bento Sketchbook, I would definitely recommend it. It's a beautiful book and really draws out this sense of looking into the world and back again. So as I mentioned, John Berger was saying these things in Ways of Seeing as you know, the early 1970s. But I still take his work to be key to the development of what today we refer to as visual culture or visual studies or visual culture studies. These are kind of terms we have. His work, I'd say, sets the tone of what was to come, whereby there is a consideration of visual and image culture sort of on the left of politics that is not simply iconoclastic. This was important. But equally, it is a reading of the visual that is shot through with the political. It's worth noting, for example, that the Journal of Visual Culture, very, very notable journal in the field of visual culture, ran a special issue called Ways of Seeing 40th Anniversary in 2012. That was the year, of course, that the Kochi Biennale was launched by happenstance. I feel quite old to start realizing that it's now we're about to reach the 50 year anniversary of Ways of Seeing, and I'm still talking about it, but never mind. I want to stay for a moment with John Burge's line, our vision is continually active. Just the other day, I came across an article in the New Scientist, so in a science journal. I'm just, I trust you can all see this. I've just shifted to an image here. And the headline of this article in the New Scientist was, "We thought our eyes turned off when moving quickly, but that's wrong." And I'm just going to give you a flavor of the article from the opening paragraphs of it. So it starts with, "It has sometimes been assumed that we experience brief periods without vision every time we shift our focus from one point to another, but it turns out that is wrong. Several times each second, we quickly change our line of sight, shifting our focus from one point in the scene to another. These fast, jerky eye movements each last about 15 milliseconds, and our vision is reduced during this time." And this image I'm showing you here is from the article. And it's just coming and giving that sense of, on the right-hand side, there's the way in which we see physically. But on the left is how we render that seeing to kind of formulate as that the kind of stable world outside of us that we think is out there. So some people have argued that our eyes entirely lose their ability to process visual information in this time as we move in the movement. And so the authors of this article have shown that this isn't the case. We are in fact able to absorb information from our surroundings during our rapid eye movement. And they say this kind of changes the way we approach perception, because we used to think about motor actions and perception as two distinct things. And they go on to say, what this insight shows is that we continue to interact between how we move and what we perceive, that it's not two separate processes. It's two things working together. They go hand in hand. Now, importantly, I'd say this does not invalidate John Burge's account. Indeed, his remark is that our vision is continually active, as I said, continually holding things in a circle around itself. But obviously, the science of vision and seeing has advanced hugely since the 1970s. And so the work further enriches, I would say, our account of the visual. Now, there's quite a lot on scientific imaging I cover in chapter 7, I think it is, of the book. It's a bit a very particular interest of mine. So a kind of broad overview of visual culture I'll move to now, just sort of following that. Three kind of main dimensions that I might suggest. So the first is the biological, which is what I've just been referring to the question of our faculty of vision, and related to which is the key term of visuality, which kind of brings back that sense of choice as well, how we choose to look. And how we choose to look, on the one hand, can be conscious, but also how we choose to look, as on the left image, on the left-hand side of this image, there's also ways in which the way our brain, for example, chooses to look is part of our visuality. A second dimension of the visual culture as a term would be perhaps the artistic, and I mean that in a very broad sense, relating to the arts, broadly raising questions about, for example, a visual canon, as we talk about the a literary canon. You know, what are what is the culture, the visual culture that we uphold, and who's output outside of that as well, important questions. So this raises questions about cultures of production and reception. And then the third array of visual culture is perhaps the everyday. This is a slightly more kind of anthropological sense of forms of life related to the visual. The development, for example, of imaging technologies, not least the mobile cameras in our mobile phones, has altered the sort of visual fabric of our social and cultural lives. The fact, of course, that I'm able to talk to you today from the UK, well, most of you, I believe, are in India. I suppose it's part of that, isn't it? This is part of our everyday. So that's key to considerations of the visual culture. And in this way, visual culture is very often interested in the ephemeral, that which kind of ebbs and flows in our day-to-day. So this third example of visual culture of the everyday is perhaps the one that is most widely taken up as a subject of study, and where perhaps the relationship between an art discipline and visual studies is sometimes it works, it brings it together very, very well. And certainly artists themselves are embedded in the everyday visual culture. But as a discipline, perhaps sometimes it's also been a way of separating, it's caused separation. In one of the, in the introduction to, there's several introductions to Nicholas Mertzoff's The Visual Culture Reader, which was first published in the 1990s, but I think, well, there's been various iterations of it, but I think the introductions have remained the same. And one of them, his collaborator, Irit Rogoff, characterizes the emergent field of visual culture in the following way. Visual culture opens up an entire world of intertextuality in which images, sounds, and spatial delineations are read onto and through one another, leading ever-accruing layers of meanings and of subjective responses to each encounter we might have with film, TV, advertising, artworks, buildings, or in urban environments. Crucially, she remarks, images do not stay within discrete disciplinary fields such as documentary film or Renaissance painting, since neither the eye nor the psyche operates along or recognizes such divisions. Instead, we can understand and study visual culture as experienced in a more fluid and complex manner, like a scrap of an image, as she puts it, which connects with a sequence of a film and with the corner of a billboard or the window display of a shop we have passed by to produce a new narrative formed out of both our experience journey and our unconscious. So it was really, in a sense, this scrap of an image, the bit that can move through different mediums, that I was particularly interested in and led me into image studies. So I'll move now to the second point then, to image studies specifically, which is the term I've tended to always use. Now, I could give you a kind of a fuller history, a kind of biography on this, as to why and how I got into the consideration of the image, but perhaps just one specific note I'll give. I co-edited Image as a Reader in the early 2000s with my colleagues, John Simons and Arthur Piper. We brought together about 100 different readings on the image across lots of different areas and disciplines. And that also led me into working with people like WJT Mitchell and also James Elkins. And I believe James Elkins was presenting in one of these sessions as well. Now, the position I started to take was that the field of visual culture sits within the inquiry of the image. And I would maybe give an analogy here of Roland Barthes' positioning of semiology and language. So semiology, the science of signs, and language and linguistics more broadly. Saussure, in inaugurating the science of signs back in the early part of the 20th century, was suggesting of a meta-language, whereas Barthes took language as the active component. And it's a kind of deconstructive point for Barthes in that effectively, it's drawing on the sort of Derrida's position of there can be no outside of the text. So what he sort of suggests of, so what Barthes suggests of semiology is that Semiology has no substitutive role with regard to any discipline, but will, on the contrary, help all the rest. The wild card of contemporary knowledge, he calls it, as the sign itself is the wild card of all discourse. Now, in a way, I would say visual culture can play this wild card as well of all of these different disciplines we might move in and out of to do with the visual. So when we think of the claims of the visual turn as opposed to the linguistic turn, visual culture is positioned to cut through all forms of knowledge. Yet, I took the image as the wild card of the wild card. As such, my book, Image Studies, places visual culture as a chapter within the broader picture of image studies. The publisher at the time wanted me to include visual culture in the subtitle, and I resisted it because, you know, it's obviously a marketing ploy because that term is recognised, but I really resisted it because I did, because they wanted something like, you know, image studies, explorations of visual culture. And for me, visual culture was one consideration within a broader consideration of the image. So to have pulled that one out for me would have been slightly problematic. So the book is divided into two main parts. There's part one, which is defining images. And there's three chapters there. There's one called Beyond Semiotics. There's one called Understanding Images, which I'm going to pick up on a moment of that in a moment. And there's also a chapter called Image and Text. And the relationship between image and text is something I've always been particularly interested in. So these opening chapters set out specific arguments relating to the visual turn, positioning the image as different to the text, and looking for tools and techniques to sort of stay with the image as best as possible before being drawn back into language. In the second part is called Image Practices, and the chapters are drawing and painting, photography, visual culture, scientific imaging, and image and information. Now, I could have gone on and had loads and loads of chapters, but I had to, I mean, there were constraints on how long the book was allowed to be. And some would argue things like photography and drawing and so forth could be wrapped up into visual, or all of it could be wrapped up into visual culture. But I tried to distinguish visual culture as a particular lens through which to look at things. Right, I'll leave that sort of there for now. I'm going to turn much more explicitly then to the problem of the image, as I'll put it. The problem of the image is precisely its power and potential, is that it's very hard to define. Most obviously, the image is predicated on being and not being at the same time. And I'll just bring up, this is, some of you may have come across this, and in fact, it's in, I reproduce it in the book. This is by Tom Mitchell from his book, Iconology. It's a family of images diagram. What we can say is that there are lots and lots of different things we call images. There's pictures, statues, illusions, maps, diagrams, dreams, hallucinations, projections, poems, patterns, memories, and also ideas. That last one is complicated. I think it's particularly kind of vexing to think about. There's also, within this variety, we kind of reveal a lot of unevenness in how the image is characterized and from different perspectives and domains and disciplines. What we see from Mitchell's topology or typography is as a shift from the sort of picture, the visual image is sort of picture, through to the virtual. So on the left of the diagram are graphic and then optical images. So we kind of have the hard physical picture to the more sort of impermanent picture. So it's still physical. So when we look in a mirror, it's a kind of, there's a physicality to it, but of course it disappears as soon as we move again. In the middle, we have the perceptual, which relates back to what I was just describing from the article of The New Scientist. So with this sort of image. And then on the far right, we have the mental image, how we compute images, whether in real time or as memories or dreams. And finally, the category of the verbal image. So things like metaphors and descriptions. Now, interestingly, Mitchell does not appear to have a root meaning of the image. He puts the image as a root, but he doesn't necessarily give a meaning to it. It's listed here as likeness, resemblance, and similitude, which I would say we can consider as the image as kind of mode, procedure, and operation. Now, one of the things that Mitchell goes on to reference is the Greek story of two painters who they hold a competition to see who could paint the best picture. Now, this image here is obviously not a Greek painting. It's Levet's painting from the 1870s, but I just use it as a kind of descriptor. So as the story goes, the two painters show each other their paintings, and Zuix presents a painting of grapes that appear to be so real and succulent that the birds fly down and peck at them. But his competitor, Parasius, he then turns to his competitor and says, "Can you now unveil your painting?" To which Parasius reveals that the curtain itself is the painting, and so wins the competition because it tricks the other painter. So we can, I've got another example of grapes there, again painted, beautiful luminance of those. This is Karen Kneffel's work. And this is then a painting where just playfully we see the idea of the curtain being pulled back. Now, it's this there and not there that is really, really important to how we define the image. It's the condition of the image itself. So as Mitchell explains, when a duck responds to a decoy, or when the birds peck at the grapes in a legendary painting, they're not seeing images. They are seeing other ducks or real grapes. The things themselves and not images. So when we look at images, what we tend to do is to say, that is something, but it's also not something. I know this is an image, but it's something I can also refer to as well. And so we start to, if though you show an image like this to somebody who's not familiar with image making, they might say to you, certainly for a very young child, for example, they might not refer to this as grapes. They would just say colour. And they'd say, look at the grapes. And they'd say, what, you mean the colours? So this ability for us to move in and out of the image is one of the important kind of distinctions of things and images. And of course, it's, you know, very eloquently played with in Magritte's This Is Not a Pipe. Okay, so I'm also just going to quickly, as a slight digression, what I do in the book, just so if it may be of interest to some, is that I try to move on from the family of images and I give my own sort of diagram, which is this ecology of images. And I spend quite a lot of time going through this. I'm not going to do that today because I want to talk much more explicitly about this question of the image in a more philosophical sense. But I use this to start to open up the technique of how do we stay with images to explore images rather than to always come back to language. And I'm happy to talk about that later, but it's just to let you know it's in there. Okay, I will, some of you may know this. This was a photograph I took in Kochi a number of years ago. It was a piece of unattributed work on a garden wall. There was, as far as I understood, is in relation to the Biennale being in the Kochi, in Kochi city. A very simple, you know, in a way it's similar to This Is Not a Pipe in that it's absence and presence, but of course it's present to us, but also evokes notions of absence as well. In this case, I think there were questions about who is allowed and who isn't allowed to be seen, for example. Okay. So this brings me to, I'm going to just stop sharing this for a moment. This brings me now to the essay I wrote called Image Degree Zero, where I want to problematize what I call the empirical image, these things that we can point to. And instead, I've become more and more interested in what I would refer to as the image as potential or capacity. Okay. So I've sort of found myself taking a slightly odd position to almost suggest that there's no such thing as the image. While we can cut a picture in half, we can't reasonably cut an image in half. And so I developed this point in the essay, Image Degree Zero, where I seek to understand image as being with a capital I, to echo the way we refer to text from the sort of post-structuralist readings of text with a capital T, as more than just simply things we write down or type out, but text as a kind of experience, a sort of site of practice. So the theory of text is a deliberate point of reference in my essay, since I actually tried to inhabit the essay by Roland Barthes called From Work to Text. So in my case, it's from image to image with a capital I, or imagement. I'll move on. Let's move swiftly on. So Barthes' shift to the text in his essay is aptly described by him with reference to Einstein's theory of relativity. It allows for, he says, relativization of the relations of writer, reader, and observer, a contrast with the traditional notion of the work for long and still conceived of as in a sort of Newtonian way. Today, the detection of gravitational waves only further weighs upon our understanding of Einstein's theory and crucially his notion of space-time. So as we know, the scale on which space-time is curved is large, thus accounting for substantial observable bodies in the universe. Yet still the theory breaks down when we turn to the smallest elements, when we turn, for example, to the uncertainty of quantum mechanics. So if my suggestion here, and it's a playful one, but if we are to understand image with a capital I properly, it is like concerning ourselves with the relativization of relations. But more than that, we need to consider image, as we did with text, in such a way that it is perhaps analogous with the still unresolved tension between gravity and quantum matter. If we are to understand image at its kind of quantum level, and I mean this slightly literally, but also I mean it metaphorically, we need to go beyond the fixed, resolved image of picture and the sort of the empirical image, as I mentioned, and instead approach it as a kind of an epistemological condition, or as I term it, image degree zero. Okay, so echoing Barthes' essay From Work to Text, which has seven propositions, although he talks them as touches and like prompts, I'm now just gonna work through these seven propositions and I'll try to go relatively quickly now. Just a quick note, I wrote the essay, it was originally prompted by consideration of the Greek term dynamis. It was for a project that was about the concept of dynamis, which can be understood as ability or potential in the ancient Greek. And it's opposed to the actuality of energia. So there's sort of energy and dynamis, and dynamis is a bit more like a kind of rhythm that ticks through the actual energy. Okay, so now the first two propositions I'm gonna just skate over completely because they are essentially what I've already discussed in relation to Mitchell's family of images and things like the grapes sort of example. I start with the first proposition is the image is not something. And the second one is the image is invisible. It's sort of both there and not there at the same time. So I've already gone through that. I then think that it opens up a structural question of where is the image? And here I turn briefly to neuroscience, which I think raises some interesting points. So the workings of the brain, So this is the third proposition, picturing the image. The workings of the brain, so here referring to kind of both inside and outside of the area we call the brain, but this sort of neurological mechanism, provides a means and power of calculation that goes beyond our conscious comprehension, the latter being only the 10% of our non-autopoietic brain activity, dependent on the other 90% of our autopoietic brain, i.e. we're only really conscious of about 10% of what our brain's doing. And that goes back to the image I showed you from The New Scientist. The bit on the left is our constant brain activity. The bit on the left, that was on the right, on the left, where it's the neat image, that's our sort of 10% of our brain, conscious brain activity. So our ability, so the billions of neurons in the brain resemble trees of many species and come to many fantastic shapes. And crucially, it is the totality of their connections, or the connectome as it's called, that makes us who we are. The first thing any connectome reveals is that it's unique. To date, we are still only able to observe a very limited subset of our neurons. We are unable then to see how we relate from one moment to the next, and how we retain distant memories, for example. Our ability to image relates both to a fast-moving stream of thought, neural activity, and the stable grooves we hone through our brain, kind of physically, like sort of valleys in a landscape, to ensure that we look the right way. The neuroscientist Zeki, for example, remarks, a picture cannot represent an object, only the brain can do that. Having viewed an object from many angles and having characterized it as belonging to a particular class. I'll just go back to my slides here. So I'm just gonna make an analogy here with the three-dimensional 360 degree space of CGI imaging and so forth, the mathematical coding. So our ability as humans to pick up information constantly allows us to create things from multiple dimensions. So I can see a piece of furniture from one angle, but I know it's a piece of furniture because my brain can tell me that there's another side to it. And this is where I would say it's got similarity to CGI. Of course, unlike computer modeling, in which variables are preset within a closed system, we maintain in our neurological network an input and feedback system that presents a fluid sense of reality, yet is equally prone to error, as with optical illusions and affects the sort of cognitive impairments we may have. I was mentioning to Premjish just before this started that my eyesight's been changing as I get older, and I'm certainly realizing that my feedback system is changing in how I see. So nonetheless, this I refer to then is zero-degree seeing, a world in which the camera, inverted commas, can inhabit all points of view at once and provide impossible perspectives, out of which we gain a semblance of shared reality and navigable space of the image. So neuroscience starts to, again, shift and open up and enrich the kind of problematics of the image. I move on to the fourth one, which is the image is infinite. The image is infinite, which is not to say the image extends infinitely. So it's the empirical image does not extend infinitely, but image as capacity, I'm suggesting, is inexhaustibly infinite. We need to consider not so much the media of image then, but more a medial image, the notion that it occurs through many points at one time, such we might say of the connectome, as I've been mentioning, or as we might say of the wave-particle duality. As Einstein once expressed it, we are faced with a new kind of difficulty. We have two contradictory pictures of reality separately. Neither of them fully explains the phenomena of light, but together they do. I mean, he's talking here about his problems of gravity. So, I'm using an analogy with quantum physics and gravitational physics. If we think in terms of wave and particle, we might just as well consider a spatial reading. Understanding dynamis, going back to the term I mentioned, the Greek term of the potential, as dimension seemingly requires us to think beyond our ordinary dimensions. Just as imaginary numbers are a serious pursuit in mathematics, which we imagine as a new kind of number at right angles to the ordinary real numbers, perhaps we need a new conceptualization of image, capital I, as perpendicular to the reality that brings empirical images to our attention, to the surface of our membrane of existence. In the early 20th century, we identified quarks with lengths of a millionth of a millimeter. Today, with the Planck length, we have reached a smaller scale by a factor of a billion. So we're getting smaller and smaller and smaller. The smaller we go, the more structures we uncover and can imagine. One way of unifying current observations is to suggest we live in a four-dimensional brain, so like a membrane, which sits within higher dimensional space-time. From the viewpoint of the positivist philosopher, as Stephen Hawking reminds us, one cannot determine what is real. All one can do is find which mathematical model describes the universe we live in. Similarly, we cannot determine image so much as model its potentiality, which, like the text, is seemingly infinite. Okay, so I've nearly finished. I'm just going to bit more on this quantum bit, and then I'll skate through the final few ones. So historically, the development of the perspectival system of representation has been an important technique of imaging, since it provides a rational point of view of origin. We see it here in the CGI image. It has a point of view. Yet, of course, this always stops short at its singular point of origin of a complete account of image as medial physics, as I'm suggesting, of a zero degree image, or of a spatializing of image through all matter that surrounds us when actualizing the image. We can think of Dürer's drawing of Albertian perspectivalism as showing that the image can be cut at any point in our line of vision. So you could move the plane in that image and get a different reading. This account changes our reading of static media images. It's not about the power of the image as forms of representational magnitude and potency, but rather about the capacities and resistances of imaging. How seeing is formed of a continuous medium and continuous calculations. Even our whole universe might be thought of as an illusion, as one cut in the lines of incident rays. Holographic theories of the universe have been around since the 1990s, but a recent study claims to present the first proof that we perceive that what we perceive as three dimensions emanates from a two-dimensional field. Looking back as far as 13 billion years, the new holographic modeling derived from quantum rather than classic theories of gravity shows that the developmental structures of gravity and the universe draw upon thin vibrating strings of an initially flat two-dimensional universe. The holographic universe is a very different model of the Big Bang. It is as if imaging, in fact, goes the other way around. The flat plane that we see in Dürer's painting, so where the image will be rested when he's finished his drawing, is in fact the plane upon which the structuring of our universe takes place. So if you imagine also a slide going into a slide projector and imaging onto a wall, that's sort of the suggestion of the holographic universe. We're existing in the projection, but it's all emanating actually from a two-dimensional slide. And this shifts, this switches round during here, where we think we're drawing the lute as the three-dimensional object onto a flat plane. But the holographic universe theory suggests our whole reality is a two dimensions projected out into the reality we experience. Okay, so the fifth proposition I have in here is called avisuality, and it kind of extends this point. I make reference to reflectance transformation imaging. And I think I've got an example of this. So this is a computational photographic method some of you may be aware of. It gets used a lot in archaeology and so forth. I'll explain it very quickly. In this case, we control the light of the object, not the object itself. And in doing so, we disclose fine detail unseen by the naked eye. In the bottom half of this image is really what we see with a naked eye. But once you take it through reflectance or RTI for short, reflectance transformation imaging, RTI, it starts to reveal the mark making in much, much greater sense. And one of the things, for example, in archaeology, you can start to see is not just that there is a curl or a certain bend of a shape, but you can actually start to see the order in which marks might have been made. You can sort of see the gestural pattern in the lines themselves. So as I said, one of the things that's important about this is we're imaging light, we're not imaging the object, and it's quite, so we're imaging what comes off of objects, not what how we see something. The sculptor Ian Dawson disorientates this further by sort of messing around the system. So the way it works is you have a little black ball that is the control, and that's always placed next to the object you're imaging, and you use that to control, and it's always static. But an artist, Ian Dawson, who I know very well, he works in my institution, he attached the control ball to the camera itself and moved through space. So kind of messing around with the whole principle of it. And he made some really rather lovely images. By inverting the process, using a static light rather than a moving light, and affixing the light control, which is normally the static bit, to the camera and moving around the object, he recorded at what I refer to as a dynamic form of RTI. No single image does justice to what Dawson reveals, but as we watch the succession of pictures, we see the movement of imaging. I'll just show you here, this is what he produces. They're actually moving images. This single still, it's a very beautiful image, I think, but it's actually, we've got to understand it as moving through a whole space. And if you imagine also here, we're not just going to get the image on one plane, but we're starting to move through that line that goes through the diagonal line. Okay. So what he reveals, as I'd suggest, is we watch a succession of pictures. We see the movement of imaging. We begin to discern the ethereal word of ethereal world of imaging itself, as if we can indeed not just see the image, but touch its cloudy effervescence, as if the air that surrounded Dura while he worked is brought to our attention and imaged. Okay, there's another section in the essay called Image Efficacies. I'm very happy to share this essay because it obviously requires more steps. And I'll talk to Premjish in a moment about sharing this with anyone who wants it. I won't go into that one, but essentially what I say is that we've got to stop worrying about the empirical image and be interested in imaging and this image with a capital I. So then I end by saying, I arrive at a final inverted commas approach to the image, capital I again, that is akin to an event horizon or boundary around which images, kind of empirical images, emerge and escape. The artist Paul Klee, whose dictum is that art does not render the visible, but renders visible. So he takes out the definite article there, doesn't render the visible, but renders visible. Offers quite an important insight, I think, that line. It's not a question of reproducing what is already empirically visible, but of rendering things visible. The pursuit of the visible for Klee was through making. It is a form of genesis in itself, which is the only way to break with the codes and conventions of significations. And I think it's for this reason that the work of artists is so profound. The imaging is the work. Taken together, these discrete propositions, these sort of 7 points I've suggested, cannot be said to constitute the full articulation of image theory. I don't think that's really possible. It's a practice. As we know from the theory of the text, it cannot be resolved through a metalinguistic exposition, to recall Barthes' words here. The discourse, he's talking about the text, the discourse on the text should itself be nothing other than text, research, textual activity, since the text is that social space which leaves no language safe outside, nor any subject of the enunciation in the position as judge, master, analyst, confessor, decoder. The theory of the text can only coincide with the practice of writing. So our question of the image is that it is really only through the practice of image that we can understand image. So there is a physical sensual dimension, this is my final point, there's a physical sensual dimension to image, but also a virtuality, which arguably places an understanding of image beyond the structures of our own minds, or at least presents a complexity and malleability far beyond that of text. As with advances made with imaginary numbers that I suggested and multiple dimensions in theoretical physics, alongside our understanding of the neurobiological accounts of vision, we need to attend to image through an extended imaginary. I'll leave it there. I hope that makes some sense. I've ranged around a lot of different things. But the essay itself is meant to be speculative in that sense. So I hope you can take it in that spirit. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Manghani. And again, I think for those who are hearing you for the first time, for me, when I encountered the book, it made me unlearn a lot about images. And also made me realize that we should not take images for granted, and the idea of image for granted, and the empirical image, the idea of the image, both for granted. It cannot be. And one thing which is very fascinating is the complex approach you take, which is interdisciplinary, of course, but it straddles onto all these fronts. And what you call bring in or enrich your own study and the discipline from all the recent developments that are happening in these various disciplines. And it's very encouraging, it's very enriching. And it has also been reflected in today's presentation too. Because especially we are living in this moment when we have a confrontational relationship with the image also, where all these developments in the technologies have undermined our ability to trust what we are seeing and what we see. So it is an important moment also for all of us to think about the impact this has on our culture and the institutions also, which are built around the idea of images. So thank you for this fascinating lecture. And I'm going to ask you a few questions, but those who would like to ask anything, please either raise your hands, you can ask directly, or if you want to type it out, please type it in the chat box. We could take that up for the discussion. I will start with a very basic question. In your book, you have talked about the two binaries, the iconophilia and iconophobia, which are very crucial or which are very fundamental to our conditioning around images or how we perceive images and also the power images have on us. Would you elaborate about that? What is this iconophobia and what is this iconophilia?
Yeah, and I mean, iconophobia also sometimes referred to as iconoclasm as well. So there's a very long history of banishing the image, to distrust the image. And on the flip side with iconophilia, there's the idea of the love of the image and the sort of to be overwhelmed and so forth. Now, interesting, I mean, you did raise some points in a way, sort of political points. Historically, this division of the iconoclasm or iconophobia and iconophilia, it's tended to split sort of the left and right of politics, whereby the left of politics has often been very skeptical of the image as being seductive, of being in a kind of Marxist sense, you know, it's betraying reality. Whereas on the right, often the image has been mobilized as the means to affect power and to rally and so forth. So that was really one of the key reasons why I got into the image debates, because I mean, it's two of my PhD supervisor way back, John Simons, he was starting to ask the question, but what is the value of the image on the left of politics? And how do you mobilize that? There's a lovely line actually from John Berger, who I mentioned earlier, where he says, and I think this is where I then am interested in imaging rather than the image, because I think the image in the end either does or doesn't do a kind of work of seduction. I think it can work on the left. There's not so many examples of it, but it can operate. But in the end, we end up with a kind of certain binary. But there's a lovely line with John Berger where he talks about the idea of agitprop sort of artwork, the sort of the political, the kind of overtly political art that certainly was very current in the 70s and so forth when he was writing. And he sort of says, it's like turning the cannon to face the other way. It's sort of, it's not really doing much in the end. And it's interesting at the moment, the debates that are going on at the moment, we can end up with quite reductive positions being taken. We might be turning away from a dominant form of politics to another form of politics, but it can start to become dogmatic in its own sense as well. But what John Berger says is, what's interesting is the directionality of the cannon itself, that's also what we've got to pay attention to. And I think that's, I mean, in a simplistic sense, that also relates back to people like Bertolt Brecht, where you're not just, in his case, using drama, they're using the theater stage, but you know, if we can think of that as forms of imaging, he's not just presenting the image, but he is situating the image in a construct, and he's being very clear about that construct. That, I suppose, is very much at the heart of what I do, and that's trying to relay that there's both iconophilia and iconophobia always at work, in even in the same instance. We can be drawn to play. An example can be things like an accident. An accident happens and there's a traffic jam and everyone's just craning their neck to see, well, what's happened? But at the same time, you're saying, that's horrible, that's terrible, I mustn't look. And I think that even in our own selves, it's not just the left and the right politics. There's an iconophilia and iconophobia that can operate all the time. And we've got to sort of start to work with that in our understanding of image and visual culture. Oh, you're on mute.
Sorry, thank you for that. But I take one question from the audience, which has been shared by Sri S. And I think you have to answer on behalf of the discipline of image studies as the Zarathustra of the image studies. he asked that, please elaborate on the scope of image studies in a post-truth era.
In a post-truth? Post-truth era. Oh, okay, very good. Yeah. Well, I suppose in some ways it goes back to the point I just made that we shouldn't get too hung up on the right, the good and the bad image. There's a way in which, and my interest my original research was around images of the fall of the Berlin Wall. So I took this very specifically political image, but I wanted to question why the kind of left of the debates around, and not least the sort of socialist country sort of perspective on the fall of the Berlin Wall, was just spirited away. Now, this wasn't to say I wanted to completely condone, I wasn't trying to condone a sort of the left politics of, say, East Germany at the time, but I was interested to know why it was so easy to remove it, and why the fall of the Berlin Wall was this phrase that could just be evoked and immediately we're into a new future. So what I had to do in that project was to then search all of these iterations of the fall of the Berlin Wall. And very often it's a rhetorical device. And now, you know, so it's not just sort of visual images, it's also metaphorical images and so forth. And what I then tried to do is to orchestrate those and create those into a consideration of the different moments of meaning. And I think in a post-truth era, which is, it's a brilliant question because it's a very difficult one. I think we've got to start to reveal again. I mean, it's an old age problem. We've got to reveal again the apparatus. How is this stuff working and moving? And so my consideration of image studies as opposed to visual culture, because I think I mean, splitting hairs maybe, but because I'm interested in this imaging and this image with a capital I, I'm trying to find the qualities or the kind of energies, and to use that Greek term of dynamis, the mode through which this operates, and to potentially also intervene in that. But you can't just intervene to stop it, which is what the post-truth dimension has shown us. This, you can't just declare this is not true, or try to even argue it's not true, even prove it's not true, because it just gets swept up. So I think what we've got to start doing is understanding how things move through systems, and start to try to find narratives that also then move us through in other ways. Because we've got to, as I said, we can't just put a pin in it and sort of pop it. We've got to work with it. We've got to move through it.
Thank you. Please raise your hands if you have any questions to ask, or you can type the question.
I'd be very interested to hear the person who asked the question about the post-truth. I'd be very interested to hear what they would say a bit more on that themselves.
This was asked in the YouTube.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. But if anybody else want to ask, please raise your hand. Please feel free to ask or comment also. Please feel free to do that, or also type out your responses if you want to do that too. Meanwhile, I would now also speak on behalf of the art students in a way that, when they enter into this MFA practice, as I said earlier, that they have to submit this dissertation, and which follows a format of an academic dissertation. And this is where the challenge comes to how to blend text and image. How much image or how much text or how much, making should come into this dissertation? How could we incorporate the making into this academic dissertation, which is very textual biased? And you have in your book also mentioned about the image studies correlation. And also through these two categories or concepts, you talk about the relaying and anchorage, the two ideas, relay and anchorage. Would you like to elaborate on these two ideas, relay and anchorage, and how the text is used in these two concepts?
Yeah, it's a very good question. I mean, this could be a whole other presentation. I'd love to. I've been involved with practice PhDs for many years now, and I think there's a few things I'd say. First of all, I think we've got to stop worrying about this too much. I think we can. There's a myth of the dominance of the text to some extent. Now, myths always have a certain degree of truth to them, but I also think there's a way in which there's a myth as well, and we've got to work through it. In terms of relay and anchorage specifically, I reference those. Again, actually, I'm always going back to Roland Barthes, I know, but they were terms that he happened to use, but he never elaborated on them. I do use the work from Scott McLeod in there, where he does do a lovely development of the relationship between text and image, and I reproduce quite a bit from his, because he uses the comic book style to present ideas in a wonderful way. And he does a lot of these diagrams of the weighting of image and text, and I certainly recommend looking at those. Coming specifically about how to manage the relationship between text and image, or the text, or really text and practice, because there could be all sorts of different practices. What I think you've got to do is to really have a sense of what your practice is. It's not just, I am making this. It's, I'm making this in a sort of practice. So I think you've got to have a sense of the overall sense of where you situate with your work and what the kind of methods and modes of your work are, how it has a continuum. Because then that starts to create some confidence of what you're doing, and the individual things that you might make or produce through your practice start to become forms of the thinking through that practice, which you can then relate to specifically for, say, the dissertation or whatever. So having a sense of practice is really important, because that grounds then the reason why you actually write anything. Then when you come to do the writing, there's a kind of conceptual consideration here, and there's some practical things. On the conceptual side, I think there's got to be ways in which you position your practice for somebody who has no idea what your practice is, to let them, there's like the idea of the threshold. How do you bring them into the conversation when they may have had nothing to do with your practice? This is very true in PhD work. You will end up having a viva with an external examiner who will not have been involved in your work, has no connection to you. You need to bring them up to speed. So some of the anchorage and relay is simply there to about the audience. I've done a lot of work recently to position a lot of my colleagues' work for, we have a government audit of research. And we tended to use three main headings, context, process, and findings or insights. Now the context section, and you can mix up where you write these, but the context is that there you really can use language to contextualize the work you do. There is a history, there is a present situation. Those are things that we can talk about, and we can bring people into the conversation quite naturally, I think, through language. So context, and it can be, and there's two kinds of contexts. There's the kind of intellectual context of the work, which includes things like the history and considerations of other people's practice that's similar to yours, perhaps. Then there can also be your own personal context of why now? How did you bring your practice to this particular point? It might be that there was earlier practice that you want to reference as part of your context into what was made. So context, I think, is very important, and that would be a form of anchorage, really. The process section is where it's to let people understand the kinds of processes you went through, because again, then they're not there when you did it. This is more like relay, because you're working through and bringing together image and text. It can be very helpful because you can really show things. But what you're doing two things with process. One is you're standing up for your own methods, and all research has methods. And so that's important, because you're saying, I do it this way, not that way. And that you're making a decision, and that's important. I'm using our practice. I'm not using sociology sort of order. That's part of it. But also, of course, you're starting to reveal what happens through process as the thinking itself. And that, again, people aren't privy to that always. So that's, I would say that's important. And especially with material practices, that you can give insights into what actually happened through a material process by relay. Then the finding, I won't go into the findings so much now, but that's where you start to, you draw some threads together. But always you've got to, the thesis does not work if you take the practice out. That's got to be the kind of crux of it. I'm not sure that's maybe wishful thinking, but that's one way I would position it.
No, it's good. It's good. Parvati Nair has a question, and this is again asked in the YouTube comment. What are your thoughts on the problematic notion of the quote-unquote truth of an image in our present times?
Yeah, I suppose my kind of moving away from the empirical image is that I'm less interested in those questions now of the truth of an image and so forth. These are important questions, don't get me wrong. This is politics through and through. And we need to take a position. And of course, going with the earlier question of the post-truth era, this ability to stand up for your position has become difficult. It's become, ever more difficult. But I'm not sure I see that as a question of image in the same way that, in that I think in the end, it comes down to our politics. And I think we've got to get our politics right and stand up for things. I think image is a quality of the way we engage in the world, and it has a massive bearing on on politics. But I hope what I'm trying to get at is that we can get fixated on particular images, and that's what I'm trying to move away from, because in the end I don't think they just draw us into a rabbit hole. They don't actually attend to the politics enough in the way that I'd want to. But But the apparatus point and the imaging point is we need to be sensitive to why that happens in order to take that breath back and say, look, I'm not going to be drawn into your image. I'm not going to, you know, or I'm going to use images. To, you know, you can do it both ways. If the iconophilia and iconophobia, these are tools we need to make judgments on at certain times. And it's a political and an ethical consideration.
Thank you for that. Is there any other question? Anybody else want to ask?
There are some in the Zoom chat. There's one about what I say about linear images. Can
you speak? That will be good.
Yeah. What do you mean by linear images?
Yeah. Hi, I'm Shirish from Pune. I explore numbers visually. So just singular numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 0. So what is your take on this or any comment on that? How we visually explore the images? I don't see it as a 1. I don't see it as a 3. I see it as a 9. I see it as a visuals. Numeric, I call it numeric visuals.
Wow, that sounds lovely. Well, I'd love to see the work. When you say it's a, you see it as a, can you just describe that a little bit more? When you look at a, like if I type a number like 3, are you saying you see it differently or you mean?
Yeah, I see it differently. I make people see differently the numbers.
Yeah.
So I won't write 1. Maybe the starting of 1 will not be from as you usually try. I can start from down and go up. I write it differently, so they look different.
I mean, I think one of the things you're perhaps referring to here, and forgive me if I've got this wrong, but is also the idea of notation. And in the very final chapter of my book, it's called Image and Information, I begin by talking about the difference between image, text, and notation. So when we think about things like musical notation, we call it notation, and even and things like dance notation as well, where we try to record a dance routine, that's different to text, but it is also different to image. So I tried to go through that, and the thing I used at the very beginning, you mentioned about 0, the chapter begins with 3 circles. It has a 0, as in the numerical 0, as if I type it on a computer, which is a slightly thicker circle. Then there's, slightly thinner circle. That's right. And then there's the O, if I type it on a computer, which is a slightly wider circle.
Yeah.
And then I have a, and what's called in Japanese, the Enzo, which is what the Buddhist monks do with a brush. They paint a circle. And the point in that practice, the calligraphy practice, is you're meant to do it in one brush stroke. It's meant to be very pure. And if someone can do that perfectly, they don't want perfection, but there's a sense to it. So that they all in the book, on the page, it's effectively all look like the same thing. They're all circles. But of course they're all imbued with such different meaning. You know, hugely. One's a letter, one's a number, and one is a gesture. So I'd be very fascinated to see your work, because I think that is again alluding to this idea of image as capacity, that image is working all the way through there. And that's also where there isn't a distinction between image and text in the end. What there is these different graphical systems, which then become we acclimatize to them through our education. I don't know if that's, I think I'm just echoing what you already know.
I would like to speak to you in detail, maybe through email we can get connected. I might show you my work also.
Yeah, I'd be very happy to see it. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
But I think what you're suggesting does bring out that important point, that when I'm talking about imaging with a capital I, I really do see it cutting through sort of everything. And that's why I start getting interested in particularly in things to do with quantum physics, because we start to understand matter through everything. And I think we're on a, I think we're in a very exciting time for that. Sorry, yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah.
Yes, thank you, thank you. Thank you so much.
This is your last chance. If anybody want to ask, please raise your hands.
And don't be afraid to ask very simple, you know, sometimes what people say, oh, I've got a silly question. They're usually the best question. So please don't hesitate. So if anyone does have anything really minor they want to ask, please do, because as I said, sometimes they are very revealing questions. I've put you all off now. Premjish, I don't know whether it's possible in terms of email lists, but I think I sent you the copy of my essay, Image Degree Zero. I'd be very happy if you want to circulate that to everyone. Please feel free.
Please do.
I'll circulate it. I'll put my email in the chat here. Because that kind of gives a more nuanced account, because it's quite complicated going through all these different kind of disciplines, and it's set up as a speculative essay. It's playful, so it can sound a bit crazy. I understand that, but I hope in reading it also gives a chance to understand the moves I'm trying to make through the piece.
I'll be very happy. I'm very happy to read and also share with those who are interested.
Good.
And also looking forward to read your new work on rhythm.
Yeah, that came out last year. Yeah, so that's a book about. That's an interesting book. I'm sure a good number of you know Jitesh Katt's work, for example. He appears in a chapter I do on the city. There's three different artists from different parts of the world, and I try to reference the way they consider the city space as forms of rhythm, which I think is really productive for art practice and something I'm really keen to build on, actually, sort of working with that material with artists. Yeah.
Sure. Okay, I think it's time to wind up now, I think. Thanks a lot, Professor Manghani, for this wonderful lecture. And thanks again for taking your time out and also spending a lot of time on interactions. Thank you. And also thank you for being generous about sharing resources, as I had also written earlier.
It's a pleasure, yeah. These things get written and then they get lost in the system, don't they? So I'm very happy for people to read them. And I just want to say thank you to everyone for listening. And I know that some of these things could be a bit complicated and hard to follow. And the questions are really fascinating. And I'd love to have been in the same room and to take more time and to share with you those questions rather than one of the problems with this system. And again, this is a bit of an image studies point. This creates a very transactional way of talking, doesn't it? So apologies in some ways if I've tried to sort of answer your questions and it's not necessarily successful, but I would love to, I'd just like to say the questions are really brilliant and they are the kinds of things we all think about. And I'd love to spend a day thinking about them, walking through the city and challenging those ideas as we talk. That's a kind of modality that I think is part of the rhythms of thinking. But anyway, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure to meet you all.
Thank you. Thank you everyone for joining and being very actively participating in the discussion too. Thank you. And brilliant. All the thank you, Professor Manghani.
It's an absolute pleasure. And I hope to see, I hope to get to the next Biennale maybe, and it'd be lovely to see some of you. And
Both, do you have any comment on that? Are you there? I think he is busy, maybe.
Yeah. Good. Well, look, stay safe, everybody. And Premjish, thank you so much for being a wonderful host. It's been lovely.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. And take care. Stay safe.
Thank you. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.